Penguin Random House Audio presents Old Time Radio's Greatest Shows, Volume 1, featuring George Burns, Gracie Allen, Jack Benny, Mel Blanc, and many more. Edited by Carl Amari.
Get this and get it straight. Crime is a sucker's road, and those who travel it wind up in the gutter, the prison or the grave. There's no other end, but they never learn.
From the pen of Raymond Chandler, outstanding author of crime fiction, comes his most famous character in The Adventures of Philip Marlowe. Now, with Gerald Mohr, starred as Philip Marlowe, we bring you tonight's exciting story, The Final Payment.
Yes, sir.
I'm Philip Marlowe. Warden Riker said he'd see me at noon.
Oh, yes, Mr. Marlowe. The warden will be with you in just a minute. Excuse me, please.
Sure.
Warden's office, Sergeant Kennedy speaking. Who? Oh, the L.A. Tribune. Yeah, yeah. Sonero's execution? Okay, hold on. I got the dope here on my desk someplace. Excuse me, Mr. Marlowe. It'll be just a minute.
It's all right.
Press get hungry for the gory details about now. This is the third call this morning. Mm-hmm. Have a seat there.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah, here it is. Office of the Warden, State Penitentiary, 10 a.m., September 8, 1950. Subject, press release, paragraph 1. William Arthur Sonero, 24, tried and convicted of the robbery murder of Emil Negrotto, Bakers Beach, California, last August 5, is scheduled to be executed in a manner prescribed by law at 11 o'clock post-meridian this date. At this time, no stay of execution is anticipated. Signed, Stanley M. Riker, Warden. That's it. Huh? No, you can't talk to the warden. That's why we go through all this press release junk. Yeah, well, we got our problems too, you know. Goodbye. Sorry, Mr. Marlowe. Now, your appointment with the warden. What was it about again?
William Arthur Sonero, 24. I'm a friend of his.
Oh. Oh, yes, of course. I forgot, sir. Well, I hope I haven't offended Mr. Marlowe. That is, I'll tell the warden you're here, sir.
I knew I didn't have too much right to be mad at one Sergeant Kennedy. But today it didn't matter. Because I was mad at the whole world, and in particular what it had done to a used-to-be nice kid named Billy Sonero. And when I stood in Warden Riker's far-from-drab prison office and waited while a dapper man in gleaming Hickok cufflinks and soft gray gabardine got through talking to his wife in syrup, sticky tones, I began to get mad at him, too. But that drained out of me fast because when he hung up, he scraped the goo off his voice quickly, shook hands like he meant it, and told Kennedy we weren't to be disturbed. When he spoke of Sonero, a lot of sympathy crawled in between the words, even when he came to the point.
It's a breach of regulations for a condemned man to have any visitor other than the prison chaplain on the day of his execution, Mr. Marlowe. So first of all, just how well do you know Sonero?
Well, he sold papers on the corner near my office as a kid. We swapped gags twice a day.
And when his father died and he quit selling papers?
I never saw him again until a year ago when he got over-involved with some tin-horn gamblers. I managed to set him free.
As a private detective?
As a big brother. Went to work in a San Pedro boatyard after that. I haven't seen him since.
And then you have no idea why he's asked to talk to you today.
No, I don't. Do you, Warden?
Mr. Marlowe, do you recall the details in this case?
Well, yeah, more or less. Let's see, an old man named Emil Negrotto and his wife were robbed of $100,000 worth of uninsured jewels at their summer place at,
Baker's Beach.
Yeah, that's it, yeah. And Emil Negrotto was killed when he tried to interfere. Sonero was tied back to it by a single fingerprint and later identified by Mrs. Negrotto. I believe she thought there were two more, huh?
Yes, but Sonero denied this.
Uh-huh.
Also, Mr. Marlowe, you may recall that the jewels were never recovered.
Mm.
Sonero said they were lost at sea when the boat he fled in hit rough water on the way back to San Pedro. Now, Mr. Marlowe, do I begin to answer the question I just ignored? The jewels, I mean? Zanaro may want to tell you that they weren't lost after all. He may want to tell you where they are. He may want you to do something about them.
So the last will and testament, is that it?
From his point of view, yes.
And from mine?
A very lucrative offer. Perhaps 50%, Mr. Marlowe.
Why not 100%, Mr. Warden? Don't be a piker. I could always cross him up, you know. Now, anything else? Or were you just letting me know why the state is allowing this visit?
I was just letting you know what the state knows, Mr. Marlowe.
Uh-huh.
I know a little more. I know that Billy Sonero is through as a criminal. In his heart. Not just because he's behind bars with worse to come. He's ready to die, Mr. Marlowe. Almost anxious.
Well, then why the session? Why all the statistics? Why the invitation for me to play informer?
For two reasons. First, I may be wrong about the boy completely. Thus, his repentance is a fake.
Which you don't believe.
No.
What's the other reason?
Look, Marlowe. If anything goes wrong, you came in here as an informer. That's official.
And unofficially?
I want to give the boy a break. Sonero asked to get you because he wanted to talk to the only person in the world he thought he could trust. And right now, I think he has every right to just such a talk, whatever it's about. I only wanted to be sure he talked to the correct party, that's all. Sergeant Kennedy to show you the way, Mr. Marlowe, to Sonero's cell.
I was a bit confused. Riker seemed anxious to help Sonero over some rough hours, and yet at the same time, he was shrewd. In no time, he'd work me around to where I'd be the fastest, most courteous informer on record if Sonero was a fake, I thought. But I thought otherwise when I was alone with Sonero and knew that the Negrotto jewels did still exist.
Mr. Marlowe, why are you looking at me that way? Do you understand what I'm asking, don't you see?
Now, wait a minute. Take it easy, Billy. Step at a time. Now, you say that the jewels never went overboard.
No, huh? I never even saw them. That was a cock and bull story.
Uh-huh. And yet you want me to get them, to get the jewels and return them to Mrs. Emil Negrotto. Is that right?
Right. To Mrs. Negrotto, the woman who identified me. The widow of the man I killed. Look, Mr. Marlowe, sit down here on the cot and listen.
Okay. Now, where's the beginning, Billy?
Last August 5th. There was me and the other two, a big red-headed louse named Jesse Tapp and a girl named Gloria. Gloria Konkowski, a blonde with a little scar on the bridge of her nose.
Mm-hmm.
Jesse's girl, strictly flashy. We took my boat. It's a fishing smack, the Love Lady. We sailed from San Pedro over to Baker's Beach. I was the one who shot him, Mr. Marlowe.
And the jewels?
They were in a leather bag. Jesse had them. But after the shot, we split up fast and ran. I hid until the next morning, then shoved off in the Love Lady. I don't know about the others. I was picked up that afternoon. The rest you know.
I'm not so sure. At your trial, you swore that...
I was alone and the jewels went overboard. Well, at first I thought that I might get off, so I had to clam up, but then I... Then everything changed.
The verdict, huh?
No. An old woman whose husband I'd killed.
See what you mean. But you still didn't tell the authorities who the others were.
No, and I won't today. Both Jesse Tapp and that blonde can smell a cop a mile away. They'd only run and take the jewels with them. The law'd louse it up. I want the jewels back to the little old lady.
I always liked you, Billy.
I know how you work, Mr. Marlowe. Got enough for you to start on. It only came yesterday. That's why this last-minute rush, you might say. Mr. Marlowe, I know where Jesse Tapp is. That also means Glory isn't far away.
From where?
San Pedro, down near the docks. Now, look. There's a tough old guy who runs a dry dock and repair lash up for small boats, name of Jomo. I worked for him a year ago. I also left him the Love Lady. He spotted Tapp, had his eyes open for months for me, no questions asked. He was here to see me yesterday. He's out to find where Tapp hangs out now. He's the one you see.
Yeah, but wait a minute. What makes you think Jesse Tapp still has the jewel?
Because I saw him take him and run, and he's still hanging around San Pedro. Maybe he hit him where he can't get to him. Maybe he doesn't want to get to him until he's contacted the right fence. Anyway, Mr. Marlowe, it's a chance I'd like you to take for me. Of course, I can't talk about your fee.
Look, kid, don't you think we ought to talk to the warden?
Mr. Marlowe, I've done nothing but think. This is the only way it can possibly work. The only way it can help me and Mrs. Negrotto both. Well, will you try it?
Yeah. I guess so, Billy.
One last thing, Mr. Marlowe. If you make it by... before 11 tonight... get the word to me, will you? And if you don't make it, or it looks like you're not going to, don't lie. okay?
Okay.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.